Tigner with Early American Furnishings. I often get asked the question how I process reclaimed timber and turn it into fine furniture. So I figured we would shoot a multi-part video series walking you through some of our processes. The first step in the process is the identification and removal of any metal that's left in the material. This exercise will also help us to date the material and find out when it was originally used for construction. I've pulled out a sampling of some different types of material to help us understand this exercise. The piece in the back is a piece of reclaimed longleaf timber. It was originally squared with the broadaxe, as indicated by the broadaxe markings that are still left in the side of the piece. It also has a rectangular mortise hole that was hand cut, and that's where another beam intersected this beam in the foundation of a home. Now here I have the end of an oak beam. And this piece of oak was also a foundation beam of a smokehouse, and this is where two beams came together. The hand-cut shiplap joint was pinned together with an oak pin, very artfully constructed. This piece here is also a piece of longleaf. It's hand-hewn on one side and rotary sawn on the other three. Now, if something's hand-hewn, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's of a particular age. But rotary sawn lumber didn't come into existence until the latter part of the 19th century, probably in about 1885. So when we see evidence of something being rotary sawn, we know that it wouldn't predate that invention. So where we are in the process is the identification of any metal that's left in the material. To do that, we'll use the Lumber Wizard metal detector. Now this is a handy device available at Highland Woodworking or other fine woodworking supply stores. This helps us to locate any metal that we can't pick up visually. Once we've located it, we want to mark that with a pencil or a piece of keel or chalk, and then use a variety of tools to then extract the metal. If it's something small like brads or staples or something of that nature, we can use the nail jack. That's a pretty handy little device. Oftentimes we'll reach for the cat's paw, small pry bar, things of that nature. But most of the time, we're going to have to box around that nail using a cheap chisel that we're not worried about damaging and a hammer. Then we'll reach for the vise grips. Now, the needle nose do come in handy periodically, but the vast majority of the time, I reach for the bullnose pair. Now, this is far and away the most effective tool at extracting nails, more effective than any of the other gimmick devices that are out there on the market. Now, nails are essentially going to be found in three basic categories. Nails have been around since the Byzantine Empire, and in America, they were made from a product originally called pig iron. Now, pig iron is called pig iron because the molten iron was poured off into a ditch, and the hardened product resembled something that looked like a sow with suckling pigs. That product was then made into a rod where a blacksmith that was specifically called a nailer would take that rod and make nails individually one by one. That hand-forged product was a true square nail, and he would put a head on that product, on that nail, with a device that he had on his anvil. But beginning in about the early 19th century, we see the age of the cut nail. Now, the cut nail was a revolutionary concept whereby instead of making nails individually, they were then stamped out of a larger sheet. In fact, Thomas Jefferson even had a cut nail factory at Monticello. By 1820, the cut nail was popular and a widely accepted product in America. But by 1920, that product was replaced by the wire nail. Now, the wire nail is a far inferior nail. It's the round nail that we commonly associate as the modern nail. However, the wire nail is now being quickly replaced by a nail that goes in a pneumatic gun. Now, there was an important invention in the age of the cut nail, which again went from about 1820 till about 1920, and that's called the Bessemer process. The Bessemer process is a process whereby the old pig iron was taken and impurities were removed from the old iron, producing what we think of today as modern steel. Now I can show you what this looks like in a couple of nails that we've extracted. You can see that these cut nails, in fact, are bendable and pliable, and when I bent them over during extraction, they didn't break. That indicates that a lot of the impurities have been removed from the nail, and therefore that is made from modern steel, although it's not a modern nail. Therefore, that nail could not have been made prior to 1855. So that, again, helps us to date the material. Now, I have here a nail that I have boxed around that we are going to get on with the vise grips. And we'll see if we can extract this without breaking it off. Get on it with the vise grips and tension that up. And I was able to extract it without breaking it off. Again, that nail bent over, indicating that it is made with modern steel. Now, while I have the camera close, let me show you a true cut nail. This nail is obviously tapered on those two sides, but then when we look at those two sides, it's clearly flat from one length to the other, indicating that that is stamped out of a larger piece of metal. Now, once we've extracted that nail, we always want to go back and make sure that there wasn't a bit that broke off below the surface. And it looks like we got it all, but as you can see, I have a good bit more work to do, so I'll get that done and then we'll go to the next step.